Hello Retrofans, today I'm going to test the new firmware for the C64 Mini, and it has been announced I think 1 or 2 days ago, and really keen looking on the new features that are coming with the new firmware. And they promise that we are able now to load multiple file types from an external USB stick, and so there's a whole workaround with this the C64 drive 8.D64 image handling on one USB stick should be a topic for the past. So, and well, let's have a look. I'm going to try to get the firmware on the C64 Mini, drawing a couple of file types, and then we move on to the web page that explains how we have to configure the different file types, disk, images, cartridges, whatsoever. And well, let's start with it. And I already started the C64 Mini, and now let's have a look whether we can have some progress here. So, as an initial step, we need to go to our configuration, and here we have to say system information, and the firmware update is already on the USB stick, and it has been detected by the C64 Mini, and now we're going to update the firmware. So this will take probably a couple of moments. And we will have, mentioned before, we will have a look at a website that explains all the features of the so-called file loader. And they added a variety of different file types, starting with D64 images, ranging up to D81 images, covering CRT cartridge images as well as tape files. And I'm really looking forward whether this stuff is working completely. And so as we can see, the firmware has been applied now, and we have a new option here at the bottom. Oops. And it looks like a tiny USB stick, and let's have a look on it. And what we can see here is a list of files which are coming without an extension. So this makes this whole thing a little bit hard to organize. So my recommendation would be to create directories, folders on the USB stick, and put the certain type of files into those folders. And we have some buttons explained at the bottom of the screen. So let's see what this button is doing. This looks like it's the fast load disk option. So, and to have just a brief explanation, I've placed two demos on the disk. Now, more than two demos on the disk. I got a tape image as well. This is a cartridge image. This is just what I remember. And this is going to be a cartridge image as well, those two. And all the other stuff are supposed to be disk images. So as a first thing, I think this is what most of people are looking for, is whether we are able to load foreign disk images. And now we are going to load Galencia. And it looks like it's going to start right now. And we should have some sound as well. I hope it's not too loud. So let's have a brief check. Oh, this is just very subtle in the background. Oh, this is the Galencia intro sound. So let's press a button. And here we go. So it looks like it is running on the wrong type of SID chip. So that's perhaps something we can configure, or we can't, I don't know, that's something we have to check. But for now, let's just jump into the game and see whether we can play it on the C64 Mini. And yes, it is working. And I've got the impression that they worked on the joystick settings as well, so actually it feels much better than at the beginning. So feels much more responsive than in the first firmware versions. So let's get our fighter back. And we are already in level 2. So this is indeed a very cool feature, because there are so many new games on the market for the C64, and now we are able to run them on the C64 Mini as well. And I think this is really a major step forward, especially for all those people who are trying to avoid using the original hardware, which is something I can understand, but that's probably not my personal preference. But anyway, it is really a little bit hard to get good working hardware for a reasonable price right now. And the price for the C64 Mini has been dropped already as well. And therefore I think it's a very good option. So now we have to see how we can get out of the game. We can use the buttons on the joystick, and then we can say exit game. So the first test was successfully, and let's move on to the next stuff. Just let decrease the volume a little bit. So the next thing I'm looking forward to is the cartridge support. And this is Bomberland from RGCD, as you can see, which I bought initially as a digital download, but fortunately, years later, they recreated a new batch of hardware copies as well, so I got this as a real cartridge, but I kept the digital file. And as we can see, it runs very well on the C64 Mini as well. So let's have a look at the game and see if every feature is working as expected. So now we are in the story mode. I'm going to skip the whole intro, and we can move on and play some bombs here. So as we can see, cartridge images are working quite fine as well. Can't see any major difference compared to normal C64 now. And this is very interesting, because here we are able to use even more people, more joysticks, so we can enjoy the game in two-player mode as well. And this makes this whole C64 Mini a very nice party console. And well, anyway, I'm not going to bother you with my lack of skills playing games. I'm just going to test whether all that stuff is running. So let's jump to the USB drive again. And one thing I need to show you in the file browser, we are able to add options to the file name to configure certain settings on the C64. And one thing is this so-called fast disk, which we can enable and disable here with a button, but we can add an extension to the file name as well. And this should force the C64 Mini to use a more accurate disk emulation. And one thing I'm usually use for testing this is an old demo from Reflex called Cafe Odd. And the funny thing is that usually this demo starts, and plays music and shows some screens and all that stuff. And then it kept going, but it refuses to load things from the disk. And initially you won't recognize this because it keeps playing the music and showing some scrollers and all that stuff. But in between there are some parts missing. And as we can see, the loading took quite a long time, much longer than compared to the other stuff we tested right now. So the C64 Mini is actually in a different loading mode or disk emulation mode, and now we are required to press a key. And well, this is something I could have configured as well. We are now able to reconfigure the buttons on the joystick. So, and this isn't what I haven't done yet, I'm sorry for this. But we got still our virtual keyboard, and here we are able to press F1 for the old SID chip, and then it should start already. So let's have some music. So far so good. So now we have to wait a little bit until the first part is loaded from the disk, and perhaps it is covered by my camera output. There should be a disk symbol as well, so it was briefly seen in the corner. And as we can see, the first part has been loaded from the disk, so the demo is running. So the disk emulation is far good so far. And as mentioned, this is one of my main test demos for disk emulations, like on the Pi 1541 for example. And I just saw it on Forum 64 that other demos are running as well, but we got a problem, we can't change a disk right now. So for all those multiple disk games and demos, this is actually the one thing we have to live with, so we can't change discs. So you either get a version of the game that fits on one V1 image, for example, or you get one of the Easy Flash conversion cartridge image files for the game. They are widely available, you can find a lot of them on CSDB, for example, and then you are able to play every game, even if it comes with multiple disks of this size. So fine, this demo is running as well, so you're not going to waste that much time with this demo. Oh, that's a very nice thing. And then what I got as well is Lift Trousers, which is a special disk format, special cartridge format, because for Lift Trousers we are able to save our game progress on the cartridge, and this would be very interesting whether we are able to do so. So let's just start into the game. Output. So here we are able to save and load to a disk which isn't existing right now, but what we want to check is whether we are able to save on the cartridge image. So I have to admit I haven't played the game for years, and which is probably not right, but you know what I mean. So I'm very bad at it, I guess. And I already exploded, that's not so good, because it's hard to save any progress if there isn't one. So let's try it again and see whether the C64 Mini is able to save the cartridges as well. You can mount disk images or cartridge images as read-only as well. So if you are afraid of getting lost of something, or if you really want to have a clean start every time, then you can do so. And but in the digital world, I don't see that much need for having a write protected disk. So. Well, it would have been good to read what the mission is. So actually in Rift Trousers you play as long as you survive, but you got several objectives to fulfill. And so just trying to fill them over with them is not the test. Get out of the water. Of planes and get killed. It's much harder than I thought. Well, if you're trying to avoid this, it's very easy, and if you really want to force it, it is quite hard. So, let's see whether we can find food. It's your best option. Die. Now we destroyed the boat. Okay. Maybe that's going to be my new strategy. So, mission completed. We have completed something, so that looks quite fine. We can have a look at the stats. Let's move on to change nothing because we have completed something. Ah, here we go. Okay, now we got options, and we got a high score for level 1. So if we're going to exit the game and restart the game, let's see whether it has saved something. No. The high score is gone. And no mission objective has been stored as well. So this is actually not working, I'm afraid of. So this is going to be the same for Sam's Journey, for example, I guess. It's going to be the same cartridge type. And it looks like the C64 Mini isn't saving into cartridge files. So this needs some kind of investigation. We can have a check when we say load from disk. What's going to happen then? Disk error, okay, because there's obviously no disk mounted. And that's going to be the same for save to disk. So, well, this is one thing that isn't working right now. But we still got the chance to save and load the so-called slots. And the interesting thing is, if we're going to play the game briefly, just to have some progress to save. In order to test this. And basically I'm trying to reach a new high score, and that's the most efficient way to die. There we go, perfectly. So now let's go to the lounge, and we got a high score here, and now we can press save and load game, and then we have this come on, 4 slots to save game states. And now we have to press the button here. So the game is still working. Let's jump out of the game. Step back into it. And then we can go to save load game. Then we load the first slot by pressing the third button. And here we got our high score back. And now we are able to save game states. So I think this is something we can live with. And the last thing I was going to test was Argus as tape edition. Because we are able to load tape files as well, we should test this. And I can't remember if there was a nice tape loader, but at least there is something, yes. So, and the interesting thing is, I guess it takes as long as it takes with a real tape drive. So, and we got some loading music as well. And we have a tape turbo that appears to be too broke. And now the Argus logo is loading. So even tape files are working fine right now. And I think, without wasting too much time, let's move on to how we can configure all that stuff on our disk drive. So let's just exit the game, and then we can switch off the C64 Mini, and let's bring back the camera. At least we're able to see something. I'm going to connect the USB drive to my laptop. So, and now we can see the screen. Let's switch just to a bigger view so that everything looks fine. So this is actually the USB stick I have used for the demonstration. So the first thing we can see is that the firmware is placed here, so this is no longer required. We can delete this, and then we can see we got a tape file, we got a different D64 image, and we got a PRG as well, which we haven't tested right now. And we got a so-called the CRT, this cartridge image. And as we can see, the date is still the 10th of February 2017, so no changes has been made to this cartridge image. So we may have to test this, whether this is working with disk image. But what I want to explain right now is that we are able to add options to file names. And the one I have used was Cafe Odd. And you can see that there is an underline AED at the end of the file name. And this forces the C64 Mini to use this accurate disk emulation mode. And we were able to run the demo with loading parts, so you can see it makes a difference. It is working. And the second thing I have tested, or not tested, but created, is the so-called JM, now we got it, file. And this is basically a text file, so let's see whether we can open this with whatever program it's probably asking us. We want to select a program, and this is called the Notepad. There we go. So, and it's appearing on a different screen. Here we go. So, and in this file, we are able to add more options to the program or the disk or whatever we want to load. And first is the so-called X option, and here we can define whether it is a PAL or an NTSC machine, if we want to use this accurate disk, and if we want to see or to hide the drive icon. So during loading, we see a small disk at the right-hand top button, top part of the screen, and if we want, we don't want to see this, we can hide it with this option. And then there's a very cryptic line called it J, and then a lot of letters coming here. And at the beginning it looks quite confusing, but actually it is pretty straightforward. But before I'm going to explain all single letters, let's move on to the C64 mini page, which we can see here. And I wasn't able to find this as a link, but if you type in the c64.com/file-loader, then you get access to the site. And here all those options are explained. And if we go down a little bit on this page, we have a lot of explanation. So we got this fast loader, switch it on and off by default, what we found out by pressing a button. And the most interesting thing is Appendix A, configuring C64 programs. And here it is explained, add flags to each file name. So we can add those flags to the file name directly. And here we are able to specify whether we want to use joystick 1 or joystick 2. You may remember during the first release of the C64 Mini, there were some games which weren't running because they were required to run with joystick in port 1. And the C64 was assigning the external joystick to port 2 by default. So there were some issues. And here we are able to define which joystick port is going to be used. Accurate disk drive mode, we talked about this. Then what I mentioned as well, make the disk appear as read-only. Whatever this means, what it means, it's clear, but whatever this makes sense or not, it's up to you. Then we can prevent the disk drive icon from appearing on the screen. And then we can use the TN option. So we can say this is going to be an NTSC program or it is a PAL program. And therefore we have those two options. And then we can move on to the so-called CJM file, which we can create for each file on the disk. And here we have the same range of options. But here we can configure the layout of the joystick. So as you may remember, the C64 joystick comes with 8 buttons in total. And here we are able to define what the directions are doing. And this is going to be the first one. That's up, down, left and right. And then we have the different buttons. And we can say what all those buttons are assigned to. So we can use the buttons for pressing space or for emulating pressing F1 like we have used in the demo and all that stuff. So it's up to you to find the best configuration for all that stuff. Here we have a nice graph showing what button is assigned in this in terms of order, and we just write here what we have what we want to do. So that's a very, very nice thing. We got a list of options here as well, and we can see we can use function buttons as well as cursor buttons, delete, return, home, run, stop, restore, shift, and all that stuff. So even for keyboard games, we are able to configure the joystick now. And this makes it very, very versatile to use the C64 Mini for almost all the stuff on the market right now. So I think that's going to be enough. The video is already half an hour long, so I think that's enough chatting, and I think I presented the most interesting features for this new firmware already. As a summary, we are now able to load a lot of different file types. The joystick handling appears to be improved, that's something I need to test. And there's just one minor issue. We can't save to cartridge image, but we can use the save and load slot function of the C64 Mini. So I hope you had some interesting time, you learned something about the C64 Mini, and it was quite interesting anyway. And so if you liked the video, feel free to thumb up, and if you want to stay informed, and if you haven't done so already, feel free to subscribe, it's absolutely for free. And I highly appreciate this. And if you have any questions, comments, ideas, whatever, feel free to use the comment section as well. So thank you very much for watching. See you for the next time, and bye bye.